Simon & Schuster Audio presents Psychos, a White Girl Problems Book by Babe Walker. Read by Tavia Gilbert.
Dedicated to the strongest person I know. Me. La terre est couverte de gens qui ne méritent pas qu'on leur parle. The earth swarms with people who are not worth talking to. Voltaire. 1. Float in the light. When I first got to rehab, I was morbidly obese. Not physically, but emotionally. I was angry at myself, angry at the world, and angry at my phone. But 4 months of rehabilitation for a possible shopping addiction and an alleged alcohol/drug addiction had brought me to a much more peaceful place. Achieving inner and outer peace had been no picnic. Rehab basically sucked for the first 3 months. People passive-aggressively punished me for being pretty. I ate 100% more white foods than I would have liked, and I shoveled way too much horse shit. Literally. Like, actual shit that came out of a horse with an actual shovel. But then something changed. I couldn't tell you why, but the last month at Cirque Lodge was magical. It was like the fog cleared, and I suddenly understood why I'd made so many bad decisions in my life. I gave in to my own healing process. I wrote apology letters and made amends with some loved ones whom I'd slandered in the past, told a nurse with bad skin that she was smart, met my birth mother for the first time, taught myself sign language, and accepted that the real reason people hate each other is because they hate themselves. I was unchained. It was like having a midlife crisis, except instead of being a sad, saggy 46-year-old with a botched facelift, I was 25 and 10 pounds lighter, thanks to a stomach virus and the medication I took to treat it. I was in the best shape of my life. I was a new Babe Walker, a glowier babe, a babe with goals and aspirations. As I looked out over the sprawling Utah mountains on my last day of treatment, I realized I was my own soulmate. I was ready to marry myself and take myself on a honeymoon to the rest of my life. In that moment of beauty and reflection, I could have never foreseen what was soon to come. When Jackson, my rehab counselor, walked me out of Cirque and helped me load my 14 suitcases, Goyar, into 2 idling black Escalades, I felt what can only be described as heartache. This was it. I was actually leaving the place that had been my sanctuary of cigarettes and fur for the last 4 months of my life. I felt like a delicate butterfly emerging from a chrysalis. The winds were strong, but I knew I had to be stronger. "So this is goodbye, I guess," I said, giving Jackson's arm a gentle squeeze. I would have hugged him, but I'm allergic to raw lamb's wool. Thanks for helping me find me.
"Babe, I was but an eagle soaring overhead, lovingly watching you scale the canyons of despair and the peaks of hope on your journey back to your true self."
"Well, you're the best eagle man I've ever known. I won't miss your almond breath, but I'll miss your spirit."
"And I'll certainly miss your liveliness and your honesty, babe. You can always call me if you feel like you're slipping back into old habits."
"Got it. I'll text you when I get home and want to do coke or buy an entire spring collection."
"All right. May your path be one of serenity and sincerity."
"And may your path lead you to a Sephora, where you'll discover that French shampoo I've been telling you about. Bye, Jackson."
"Walk in love and light, babe. Let the universe deliver."
A single tear rolled down my cheek as the Escalade drove away from Cirque, Jackson getting smaller and smaller as I watched him wave through the back window, but I wiped it away with a sense of pride. I had set out to do something, and I'd finished it. That felt good. I put my headphones on and listened to a playlist I'd curated of Tibetan monks chanting life-affirming statements, all the way to the airport. In a few short hours, I'd landed safely at LAX and was in another Escalade, white this time, on the way to my dad's house in Bel Air. Apparently, rehab had worked, because I didn't raise my voice once during the entire trip back home, a first for me. Thankfully, the flight was only mildly annoying. Some ogre tried to steal my window seat, but moved when I delivered him an icy but kind stare, instead of speaking directly to him. Then, when I was retrieving my luggage at the baggage claim, I mistakenly counted 13 suitcases instead of 14, which would have been a disaster for old babe, but new babe was all about grace under pressure and recounting. The whole moment was diffused quickly with a few breathing exercises. Such a tough scenario, because baggage handlers can be so flippant sometimes. It's like they don't care about anyone's needs but their own. But I guess everyone has a story. Standing in the foyer of my dad's house, I inhaled the aroma of Tom Ford tobacco vanille candles, the quintessential smell of home.
"Welcome back, love!" my dad shouted from the top of the stairs. "You look bloody radiant!"
"Dad!" I exclaimed, climbing the staircase to hug him.
"Let me look at you. My God, I know 5 actresses and 1 pop star who would kill their firstborn if it meant having your glow," he said as he kissed my forehead. "How are you, my sweet?"
"I'm good. I'm so glad to be home," I said, looking around. "Did you get my email about moving out?" During my last week at Cirque, I'd decided that the first order of business as independent me was getting a place of my own, so I'd informed all family members as well as the staff that I'd be relocating to our guest house. It's important to have your own space post-rehab, where you can be still, reflect on life, and not get distracted by any personal family chefs you used to fuck or pets you don't like.
"Of course, darling. Everything was moved this afternoon. Your new home awaits. I must say I'll miss you. This house won't be nearly as loud or messy without you."
"I'll miss you too, Dad, but it's for the best. Think of me as a delicate lotus flower. In order to bloom, my leaves have to float on the surface of the pond, but my roots will always reside here." Overcome by the power of my inner recognition, he grasped the banister for support.
"You sound like Keith Richards after he detoxed in 1977. I'm glad to have you home. Get settled. Dinner is at 8.
The main house on my dad's property is a post-Gothic, ivy-covered precious gem. It's huge, but it's cozy, and it's cute, but it's cluttered. Great for old babe, but too much for new babe. New babe needed warmth, light, and space, which is why the guest house made perfect sense. It was originally a 3-bedroom that belonged to our neighbors, until a dispute over a weeping willow in the backyard got ugly and my dad decided to buy their house out from under them so they'd leave us alone forever. Then we gutted it and turned it into a huge 1-bedroom, complete with an enormous walk-in closet, state-of-the-art bathroom, solarium, and sauna-slash-steam situation. Think French-Moroccan meets Tibetan minimalism meets Mary McDonald. I lost my virginity in this guest house, so it was a sentimental space for me. It had, however, been off-limits after a teeny incident during which the solarium burned down when I let my friend use it for her fledgling nail polish company, which turned out to be a cover for her boyfriend's meth lab. So it was also a dark place for me. Lightness and darkness. Now that the solarium had been rebuilt, I had been rebirthed as new babe, and my dad trusted me again, it was time for me to make the guest house my own. Little did I know, my safe space would soon be violated. After I'd watched Mabinti, my Jamaican BFF slash confidant slash housekeeper, unpack my suitcases and smudge the guest house, I had a low-key welcome-home dinner with my dad, Lisbeth, my dad's annoyingly beautiful, upsettingly tall, slightly too young and far too nice girlfriend, Mabinti, Mabinti's new bangs, and Mabinti's new boyfriend Carl, a 58-year-old white version of Randy Jackson, unclear. The lighting in the dining room was perfect, and the food was super fresh and low-cal. My dad made a typical dad toast to kick things off.
When Babe called me to say that she was off to some rehab in Utah, I thought, oh, here we bloody go. My daughter's addicted to heroin. But then it turned out that she just had a bit of a shopping problem, and I was relieved. Then, when Babe called again to tell me she was staying an extra 3 months at rehab, I knew it must have been heroin all along. As it turns out, she just wanted to put in the extra work. Proud of you, Babe.
Actually, I was addicted to coke, I interjected, then waited a beat. Just kidding. Everyone laughed.
I hear that, girl, shouted Carl.
Mabinti affectionately patted Carl's back. My brother struggled with addiction for years, Lisbeth chimed in. But he's not nearly as driven as you are to get his life together, Babe. It's amazing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.